Hi, my name is Ebenezer Asafoedu. I'm a business strategy consultant and a data specialist. Last week, we interviewed Daniel Marsh-Patrick, where he took us through his custom visuals that he has built. Today, he will continue with this interview by telling us how to build our own custom visuals. This is a whole new world on its own, and I'm so excited to actually go through this. This is something that personally I've never done before. And I hope you can also learn one or two things, especially those who want to have a career in building custom visuals, probably for a living. So stay tuned and enjoy this interview.
All right, so can you take us through probably your the custom visuals you've already built and how
they work? Certainly.
All right. So
what I'll do, I'll just share my screen if that's all right.
All right.
And I've got a lot of things queued up, so let's see how this works. As I was saying to you just before the call, I haven't really talked generally about custom visuals for quite some time.
Wow.
So it's going to be interesting to see what falls out. So I've got a whole bunch of stuff ready. Hopefully you should be able to see my Power BI desktop.
Yeah,
that's come through. It's all right. So this is visual number one. This is the one that started it all. This is the small multiple line chart. So for those of you that are new to Power BI, you're very spoiled. Small multiples are now built into the product, but we didn't have them for a long time. So
very true.
I really needed this enough to what I call hate learn the framework and put up with it. I wasn't wanting to learn how to build custom visuals. As far as I was concerned, other people built them. People that weren't me. But eventually you realize that not everyone wants what you want. So this is where you start. But for those that aren't familiar, a small multiple is, if we think we have a line chart, what a small multiple is, it's the ability to expand a chart out by a particular category. So here what we've got is city. And this chart is projected out across by city using the same scale and axes. So we can fairly compare them. You know, we can look at the temperature. These are cities in New Zealand, by the way. My nearest one is Christchurch. We can see that Auckland generally has a higher temperature than Christchurch. And because the axes are the same, we can compare those. One of the challenges we have with things like spark lines is people often forget to make the axes the same. So often it looks like one might be doing better or worse than the other. So the small multiple approach is it's a fairly powerful visualization technique. And this is something that I put together. So ultimately it's a similar thing to a line chart. You have an axis and a value or multiple values. So you can put multiple measures on, and this would let you project out. So it was quite fun once I got over the initial hurdles to build. And you could do, what I liked about this one was you can do things that, you know, you could even turn it on its head and do things like seasonality charts. So a seasonality chart being something like this, where your small multiple is a month. And instead of having a grid, you lay it out in a line. So we can see the year unfold, and we can see over time how the average temperature has been increasing. And here we've got a couple of measures. And this is a report page tooltip, which is another thing you can do with custom visuals. But we can see generally, for every month, we can see the overall trend throughout the year. So we can see that in the Southern Hemisphere, this is where winter is. So we're in winter at the moment here. But we can see over time that those values are trending upwards. So it's quite a powerful technique. So this was visual number one.
I'm already getting ideas with this small multiples with regards to the trend.
Yeah, it's a very, very powerful technique. And I think now that it's in the product, it's awesome. So this visual, I'm really just caretaking it right now. If fortunately no bugs have come through, but if bugs were to come up, I would, you know, just make small releases to this. But as far as I'm concerned now, Microsoft have got this across all the visuals. This is really just a line chart. And they're just going to push that and make it better and better. So this one was fun to work on. It taught me a lot. And I revisited it a couple of years later and rewrote it because I'd learned so much. So this is version two that we see here. And it got a lot more properties, and it's just generally a nicer visual.
Let me see what is in the field for the temperature.
Sorry?
I want to see what is in the field.
Oh, of course. Yeah, sorry. My apologies. So we've got, let me just see. I don't know if this will work. There we go. Is that zooming in okay?
Yeah.
So we've got the month name. and that's sorted by another column. We've got the calendar year, so that's, I think it's 1855 through to, this data goes through to 2014, so it's over a good century and a bit. And then we've got two measures in there. So we've got our 10-year average, which is a bit more smooth. And then behind that is the 12-month average, so that we ghost that into the background, so it shows a bit more variability. But ultimately, it just gives us something we can. But this is a technique that, you know, we can configure the grid. We can let, this visual will let the grid flow, or we can prescribe its exact size. So in this case, it's a 1x12 grid, and it will just size accordingly. Whoops. There you go. So I can drag it up and down, and oops, that's the tooltip. That's the thing when you put something right on the edge of the canvas. There we go. So when I drag it in, it doesn't respond. You know, it then hits a minimum size and will start to scroll. So these are things you all have to think about when you develop a visual. It's not just enough to get it there. You've then got to think, how do I actually make it size properly? So the difference being is that that one was more fixed, but this one here, this example on the landing page, hopefully if I remember my example, because it's been a long time, if I drag this, it will responsibly size the grid. You know, okay. So we can, and this isn't anything near as smart as what Zebra BI do with theirs. That's next level. But for my use cases, it works. Wow. So this taught me a lot. I think ultimately I've probably put about 450 hours of my own time into this, which is a lot. And it probably speaks more to my state of mind about how I work with these things. But yeah, so this one was an interesting one. The next one is this fella here, which is the violin plot. Okay. So I've been very fortunate that Microsoft put this in their marketing for a while, which was quite exciting for me. So whenever you go to the Power BI landing page, not now, but you used to see it in the middle there, which was quite cool. But the violin plot here it's a combo plot. So this was my first go at producing two plots on top of each other. So we've got the box plot, so a conventional box and whisker plot with median, mean, and quartiles. And then the distribution plot that shows the actual shape of that data around the outside. Wow. And then I added a couple of other combo plots, so a strip plot. So people might know that as a barcode plot or a dash plot. And then also a min-max plot. So this was a span from minimum to maximum, so you could see it as a bar. And there was all kinds of extra. This one was fun because it was taking a data set. Actually, let me go back. I shouldn't have got ahead of myself. If we look at this one here. We have three fields. Let me just try this one. That's what I want. So we have what we call sampling and measure. And we also have a category, but these two are the most important. So sampling is what you would know as granularity. So with Power BI visuals, you know they aggregate data. So any data you drag in, it's like a pivot table. So with a tool like a box and whisker plot or a violin plot, we need to know about the distribution of the data itself. And visuals can't reach into the data model. They're not allowed. So this is one of the key principles of Power BI visuals in the way that they only know about the data that's pushed in through these roles here. So sampling and measure data. So this was one of the examples where if we look at the visual itself, mouse, where are you? Oh, hang on. This is a Zoom It problem. Sorry, one second. I love Zoom It sometimes. There we go. If we look at the actual data in here, ignore the fact that it's done that. We have 40 rows. Well, 20 rows actually, but a maximum of 40. But each one of these is used to create a new row because this length would be aggregated to a sum or an average of a single value. And that's not enough information for us to build this. So this is one of the first examples where I had to learn, firstly, that that was a thing. And secondly, how we can take this data and transform it within the visual. So visuals can have their own data transformation logic too. And this is just something that, you know, you can't do in Power BI without significant modeling work, but you can make it very easy in a visual. So if we were to, let's just open a new one up. And we'll drag in the tooth growth again. So we'll take that sample field. I mean, I guess the easiest thing to do would be show you length first. If I just drag length in, it doesn't show anything because we've only got one value. That's not enough for us to tell what that distribution is. So we drag the sample in, and then we get this. This is all the data. It's unfiltered. But this is the overall shape of that data. So we can see that there's almost two bumps there. It's multimodal. It's not just a single skewed curve or a bell curve. There's actually a couple of bumps in there. And that suggests to us that maybe we need to put a category in there as well to blow that up. And we can start to see that, yeah, sure enough, there's three very distinct patterns of our data here. And this visual helps us to explore that. So this was something that box and whisker plot's quite good, but sometimes you just don't know about the shape until you can start to see it. So for me, this one was quite a powerful visual to work on. Only limited somewhat by the amount of data we put in, unfortunately.
That's Baleen plot.
Yes. So this one is, a little bit different, but it's good for distribution analysis of data. The third app source visual, and this one's really hard to demo succinctly. So I'm just going to do a very, very quick version of this. So this is HTML content. So this is the visual on the left as rendered. And this is a copy of the visual on the right with an option that we've allowed, which is show HTML. So what happens here in this visual, we have a measure called sales summary. And I'll just, hopefully this is going to work. So in DAX, let me just zoom that in. Oh. Last time I did this, Power BI crashed. fortunately, it's not going to do that today, hopefully. But this lets us build up HTML. This is probably the easiest part to show you, using measures, and return that as a block of HTML. And we've also got a one of the cool things that happened with visuals is we then got conditional formatting that just turned up. So I was able to add a style sheet into that, so some CSS. And this is what gets generated. So in this visual, that measure gets added. And I guess that measure as well, we also have what's called a similar thing to what we saw before with the violin plot. We have the ability to break it into rows. So if we look at the raw data rather than just the HTML, it's going to be very similar, but the visual internally looks like this. So we've got a row for each country, but here's the output that's as HTML. And we can see that this translates into this layout here because of this styling that we've added. So this is something that's called a flexbox, which is a way of laying out elements in a web page that makes them work much like what we saw with small multiples. So we can drag this visual and it will responsively move those. So think of these as little cards, I guess. And then the other thing we've done is this measure has bindings to some what if parameters. So I could drag the font size up and it would increase the font size in the generated code. And I could change the image size, which changes the, so this is a call to a web service called Country Flags. And what we can see here is there's this 32, which is based off this value here. And if I change that to 16, then you can see it changes to 16. And that's a request off to that web service, and it returns the image back into the visual. So this is a very simplistic example. I would strongly urge you to check out people like Kerry Colosco, who I think Alice probably mentioned as well. She's done some amazing work with the HTML content visual. So let me just pull this one across. She does a lot of good work with everything. But this one here, this microcharts and radial gauges, that's using that visual. So she produced this little table here with a microchart with a gauge and separate measures. And you can get incredibly, if you are so inclined, you can actually build some very compact, feature-rich, info-dense visuals using this visual. And that's honestly what inspired me to work on the Deneb visual that I was talking about, was that people's, what we underestimate is if somebody wants to create something, they're really going to want to try and do it. So how can we make the tools better for those people? How can we empower them? So I learned a lot with this visual, and that a lot of that feedback went into Deneb, which I'll very quickly do, because I'm conscious of time. And this is probably going to be a big session with Reed. So Deneb is, what we see here is something that looks very similar to a core visual. So there's a bar chart with an average line. And let me just close that down. So Deneb currently is not an app source. It's there's a website, which I'll mention maybe a little bit later. where this is all available for download, and there's a bunch of documentation. But ultimately, we add the visual to the canvas, and this is like a table. So I've got mean temperature in city. So if I get a table visual, and I take city and mean temperature, the visual will look like this. So we can see we've got 14.6, we've got 9.5, and so on and so forth. Actually, there's something up. Oh, no, that's right. But this is the concept of making a visual with a flexible data set and then letting somebody do their work inside the visual rather than in the data model or as a custom visual from scratch. So this has what's called an advanced editor. So if you've used Infographic Designer, Power KPI, Matrix, Charticulator, sometimes you get an option here to open a different view. And what we have is the ability to build a different interface inside here. So this is a visual I'm working on where we can actually write a visual definition in a JSON language and customize how many shapes get layered, how they're bound to measures. And we can even do complicated transforms. So the thing like you saw with the violin plot, we can do something very similar. So here's an example with, it's called the density plot. So this is the similar data to what we've seen, but putting it into the visual, we can actually produce something that's like this. So this is a distribution of temperature, very similar to the violin plot we just saw, but turned on its side. But it's very easy then, if we've got a design in this tool, to project it out into facets, so or small multiples. So this is the same design with an extra field. So all of a sudden now, that temperature is split by city, and I can see the distribution by city. And this is just an iterative process that I've done inside Power BI. And then if I want to make that look nicer, you can customize pretty much everything. So this is the same basic visual with some formatting applied inside the editor as well. So I can start to then change every property without having to write code. Wow. And I've added a little overlay, so my tooltips work and so on and so forth. But we'll unpack this a little bit more next week.
All right.
Yeah, that's a little bit of a spoiler for dinner. But this at the minute is my this is my focus right now. So hopefully that gives you a little bit of an idea what I'm about.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Patrick. So this one is called HTML content sample.
This is HTML content, yes.
The font size there is just a what if.
It is, yeah.
Yeah, then
so if we pull that measure up again, there is there's an image size which comes from the font size property, and the context measure sales. Is it sales? Yeah. So there's an extra. I got to find where it is now. Oh, it goes into the CSS. My apologies. So there's an extra measure called in the style sheet that uses conditional formatting. I got to find it now. Come on. There we go. So that is the what if parameter. And then we inject it into the style sheet. So as we change the font size, it gets injected and dynamically creates that CSS that we just saw. So that font size, that 8, is here. And if I change it to 23, or whatever it settles on, it changes in here as well. And that gets pushed into each element down here.
Wow.
So this is a way of starting to think about how we can bind measures to our data. And we've got examples with, where are we at? Sparklines, for instance. So David Eldersveld, who is one of my heroes with the stuff he does in Power BI, taking what he did with DAX and turning this into a very compact sparkline visual. You know, this is all just HTML. So there are some limits to what we can do with HTML. And there is, again, there's a website for this visual, which is available in the visuals manifest. So when you do about on the visual, this doesn't always work quickly when Teams is running. There we go. So there's an HTML-content.com is the website for the visual that I maintain. And there's a whole bunch of documentation there that you can look at and understand how to do things. Not write HTML, because there's so many things out there already. But how to get started with the visual. So when we submit visuals to AppSource, we do need to provide some tangible info that users can use to get started. So I went a bit crazy with that one and built a website. But it's there, and I update it when I don't do many updates to this visual because it's so extensible and it doesn't really need it. But anything you need to know particular to the visual is on that website.
Wow. I think it just, like you said, this is like a whole new world to myself, that it will take another year or two to master into this. However, I mean, for those who might be interested, what are the principles in building a custom visuals? Like, where do we start from? What do we need to look out for before you think of building a custom visual?
Okay, I think the easiest way to start, we'll do a couple things first. So I'll just show firstly a resource that has been quite invaluable to me. And this is the Microsoft documentation. So they actually have the Power BI developer documentation. Okay. So if we just go back here, it's got documentation for embedded and various other things. But they have the option on here to go to develop your own visual. And what they do is they have a whole site here around how to create a visual from scratch. So because of time constraints today, what I will do is I'll talk a little bit about the infrastructure, what we might need to get started, and just get a simple visual fired up just so that you can see what to expect.
All right.
So there are some tutorials, and they unpack the concepts quite heavily. And I think one of the key things, and this is not intended to scare, but it's more about to understand the complexities involved. So this is actually a simplified diagram of what to consider. If you want to develop a visual that's fully featured and does everything the core visuals do within, you know, there's some things that we don't have access to, but for the majority, it's pretty good now. We've got to think about three areas. We've got to think about what the user does. So they can add the visual to a page. They could open a page with a visual on. Those are two scenarios that ultimately result in a visual being created on the canvas. They can open the properties panel. They can click on a hyperlink that might be in there. They can put a filter on it. They can hover a mouse over something. And what our visual needs to do, this area in the middle here, is it needs to wire everything up. These events that happen on the left, they need to be wired up using logic inside your visual to call things that the API for Power BI gives us. So these are actions, this blue color here. So when things happen, the visual host that gives us our container for a visual might do. But then this area here is what we call the host services. And these are things that do things on our behalf. So I'll talk a little bit more about that in a second. But ultimately, something like if you wanted to display a tooltip, you have to ask Power BI to display it. You don't have control over what the tooltip looks like. You just have the ability to tell Power BI that I want that tooltip to be displayed, and here's what I want to go in it in terms of values. Now, value could be something like a category and a measure. So when we see standard tooltips, we just get very simple, maybe a color and a category and a measure and maybe multiple lines. We can send that in. With a report page tooltip, it's a little bit different. We have to use what's called a selection. So when we talk about selections, imagine the row context that we see going into a visual. So, you know, when we just looked at the visuals a few minutes ago and we could see the table, when we view the data behind it, the visual doesn't know anything about the data model. And I'll have a slide to show this, but I'll just tee you up for it. Power BI pushes the data in, and that's what we have to work with. So we just get basically an object with some values in it. And we know what the value's name is and so on and so forth and what number format it has and things like that. But we don't know anything about which table it's in or what other fields are in that table. We just know we've got this field or this measure and the data looks like this. So what we have to do with things like report page tooltips or when we click on a selection and it highlights other visuals, we have to ask Power BI to do that for us. We just say, you gave us this data and a user clicked on a shape that represents row 3 in that data. And Power BI says, okay, cool. I gave you this for row 3. I'll see if anything else on the page or in the report will respond to that. But that's it. We don't really have the ability to say, I need to cross-filter the visual by this particular field. So we can't dynamically create those things. We can only work with what Power BI gives us. So this is a bit hairy, but you don't start out with everything. This is really just the way of this is to manage your expectations and to give you an idea as to what we as developers need to do to give you a fully featured experience. But going back to that point we talked about, this is a bit of a simpler abstraction of the process we talked about. So when you as a user, we'll start on the left here. When you as a user choose a visual, whether it's a custom visual or a core visual, the principle is similar. The visual goes into the canvas as a container, and it exposes what are called capabilities. So a capability, we'll see this in a minute, a bit more detail, but capabilities are, they're like a manifest of information that the visual has. Think of it as some metadata that Power BI reads and says, okay, I need to create what we call data roles. You might call them fields, buckets, wells, yeah, whatever. Everyone's got a name. Internally, these are called data roles. So axis, legend, and value. We actually create some JSON data that Power BI reads that creates these fields, these buckets. So our visual manifest can tell Power BI that when it's added to the canvas, but we can't dynamically change those. When the visual is created, we can't change them. It's just not something we could do because the visual can't communicate outwards. But once we add data to these fields and the conditions are satisfied, so we can specify conditions. So if we only add to one, we may not want anything to happen. So we can control that a little bit. And if we add any filters, that's going to produce a query that Power BI runs on our behalf. So the DAX that Power BI generates to give us the data we just talked about, we can't control that DAX. We just have to do what, you know, we say how the fields are exposed, how they get added, and then Power BI works that out for us. So we don't see this, but this is what happens in the background. So that runs against the model, and it doesn't care where the model is either. So our visual doesn't care whether it's import, direct query, streaming data. It just doesn't know. As far as it's
what
concerned,
Power BI has given.
Yeah, that's right. And this is all about keeping the visuals. You know, some people do have concerns about visual security. This is one of the things that is done to make sure visuals can't do more than they should. This is all about, you know, zero trust, making sure that we only can do what we should be doing. So this, you know, for lack of a better expression, it gets returned to something that's analogous to a table. It can get more complicated, but for now we'll stay there. And then when this arrives, this is when our logic can run. So up until this point here, no code has run inside the visual.
It's all Power
BI. This is all done by Power BI. And then our logic might render a visual. So in this case, it's a bar chart. I've just shown that example. And then our chart will sit there until something else happens over here. So if we change a field or we resize it or something like that, then it will go back and repeat this if it needs to. So this is all done by Power BI. So we have a little bit of an opportunity here. And I have a whole other presentation on the security element of visuals that is a little too detailed to go into here. But this is really the only point where we could possibly introduce some logic that could do something nefarious. But it only can work off the data it gets. So, you know, obviously there's always a risk with data, but it only knows about this. So this could be meaningless, but again, my friends in InfoSec will tell you that they can profile over time. But what I would say is, for the most part, don't worry too much about some things. Always be cautious and always be curious and always work on the basis of, I should really make sure it's doing what it does. If a visual's certified, it won't be doing anything nefarious because Microsoft have reviewed it. And they're not allowed to do certain things. And if they do, they don't get certified. Simple as that. Any visual in AppSource, if it's uncertified, there's some basic scanning that's done for any malware. But it is possible to maybe do something. But we have to supply privacy policies with our visuals. And anyone worth their reputation, I like to think anyone, I certainly don't. I just use the data for display purposes and my privacy policies state that. But hopefully people are upfront about that in the privacy policy. And if people aren't, the community in the past has noticed these things. And often these things can be rectified quite quickly. But anyway, I digress. But if we talk about that visual a bit more. So each visual is hosted inside, we call it a sandbox. So when we add a visual to a page, we get this container. Think about the container as a walled garden. So what that means is if any of you know HTML, a custom visual is stored in what's called an iframe. This is an inline frame. And it's effectively, for some web dev people will probably not like this description, but for the purposes of simplicity, it is a small separate web page within a web page. This is probably the easiest way to explain it. But because it's its own thing, it's isolated from the main window. So we can actually apply, so the Power BI window can actually put restrictions on it. So what it means is that we put restrictions on this, so it can't talk to the main window. So what we can't do within a visual is override the main Power BI page. We can't change its styling. We can't call things inside the window unless they expose it for us. So there's actually a very, that visual host we looked at here, these services are available to us, but nothing else. So we can't talk outside this box. So these things like creating tooltips, requesting filtering operations, these are all things that Power BI exposes to us, and we can't do any old thing. We can't jump out of this frame and start playing with the page and screwing with other visuals. We're just not allowed. So as long as it's on the whitelist, we can do it. And it's communicated to the window by that API. The other thing it does is it strips out the domain. So when we talk about the domain, that's the, for lack of a better phrase, that's the website hosting the visual. So when we're on the Power BI service, we're at powerbi.com. We're on the Microsoft domain. Our visual, because it's its own internal tiny web page, it has an origin of nowhere. So it's like an island in the middle of the sea with no real sovereignty. It doesn't belong to anywhere. It's like international waters. Now, international waters can be scary, but what Power BI does is it says, I'm taking away your identity so that if you tried to talk out of my window to another site somewhere else, you don't belong to me. So you can't do things pretending you're Power BI. So what that means is there are some sites, like many sites, actually have restrictions on their services. So YouTube is a good example, where if we want to host a YouTube video, it doesn't let empty domains host content. And a lot of people actually block that. So when we talk about visuals like HTML content, even though we can put whatever HTML we like inside a visual, we're still limited by the security restrictions that Power BI puts on us. So if I try to load a YouTube video, YouTube says, I'm sorry, I don't trust you because you don't have an origin. And we can't change this. We don't have the permission to say, actually, yeah, I'm totally from powerbi.com. We're not allowed. The main window doesn't let us do it. But there are services like, say, Vimeo, which Discovery I use a lot, that do allow this. So we can host videos if the remote site lets us. But this is just something to bear in mind with custom visuals. There's very few opportunities for any shenanigans. We also don't have access to what's called, hopefully most people who use the web are familiar with the concept of a cookie. So a cookie is something that stores state. So if I visit a web page, it might remember things about me. We can't do that in custom visuals. So we can't scrape stuff we might be able to find and store it for later. Each visual, if I had three violin plots to a page, each violin plot doesn't know about the other violin plot. It's not allowed to talk to its other visuals. We can't use those cookies to share information. It's just not allowed. And the only thing it does do is script execution. So that's our visual logic we talked about. That's the only privilege it has, is it's allowed to execute a script. And that's where you could potentially abuse things. But anyway, the last piece we want to cover, because these are things I'm simplifying for the documentation that I showed you. These are probably easier ways than digesting. When we want to write a visual ourselves, there's two parts to it. We have our local environment. So when we write code, we have an environment that we actually write that in. Now, Power BI visuals are written in a language called TypeScript. So for those of you that are not familiar, you may have heard of JavaScript. JavaScript is a language for the web. TypeScript is what's called a superset of JavaScript. So JavaScript is known as a dynamically typed language. So what that means is it doesn't pre-compile. So if you've ever written a piece of code in C or Java, or one of those languages that's what we call statically typed, it will compile your code and then run it. JavaScript kind of just runs on demand. Again, it's a bit more complicated than that, but JavaScript is Python's kind of similar. Ruby is very similar. These are dynamically typed languages that are easy to learn, but because of this, you can get errors introduced that don't get picked up until your program runs. So what TypeScript is an initiative by Microsoft, and it sits over the top of JavaScript. So it's basically like writing JavaScript with a few extra features, and it can do things like check your code similar to how the C# and the Javas do before you run it. So you still may get errors, but it's just a way of producing more reliable code. And then this gets what's called transpiled into JavaScript. So you write code that looks like JavaScript with a few more tweaks, and then it gets, when it gets published up to Power BI or packaged, it gets translated to JavaScript. But the other components are you use Node.js, which is a JavaScript-based development environment. So you need to install Node on your machine. So you need an environment to edit. You could use a text editor, but I like Visual Studio Code, and that's where my project files are stored. I install Node, and then I install what's called the Visuals SDK. So this is all in the, we'd be here for maybe 20 minutes walking through this if I had to do the whole thing. So I'm just kind of abstract this. And on that documentation site, there is a walkthrough that shows how to do it. So you install the SDK, and then you have a local development environment to use. Now, the next thing is that when you've got your code, you have to debug your code, you have to test your code. So the way that's done, and it doesn't seem very intuitive, but it does start to make sense, is you do it in the Power BI service. So you don't use desktop. The reason being is that desktop loads packaged visuals. You want to be able to debug quickly. And what Microsoft do is they make a special visual available called the developer visual. And we'll show you how to turn that on in a minute. That gets added to a report like any other visual, and it communicates to your machine. When you start your debugging environment, it will communicate to PowerBI.com through the cloud to your machine. And in order for that to be successful, PowerBI.com obviously has its own secure certificate. So if you're familiar with HTTPS, secure HTTP basically ensures that a site is as secure as possible. We have seen some issues with HTTPS over the years, but we're getting better with that. This effectively gatekeeps anything from outside. So what has to happen is on your machine, you have to generate a certificate that is valid for PowerBI.com. Otherwise, you can run this and this won't see it. So what it means is you don't have 50 people building a custom visual all of a sudden appearing in your environment. It's only the certificate you create. So the SDK creates that certificate. And it makes it valid for your account, basically, your Power BI. So when you run the environment, it allows it to go through. So that's the short version. We're still going to do a very short version of the tooling. So I got a window here. I do. So how might we do that? So I have, hopefully you can see
PowerShell. So this is our local development environment.
This is my machine. So I have a directory here, C visuals. Now, I've installed node.js and I've installed the Power BI
SDK.
Again, that's all in the documentation. To do that, it's probably going to take about 10, 15 minutes to download the installers and go through the process. So I don't want to kind of, as nice as it is talking with you, and we could probably fill the time, I wanted to kind of keep the flow going. So to check we have it installed, we can run PBI Viz, and I'll just put version as a switch. So I've got version 3.2.3 of the SDK. And if I want to create a new visual, I give it a name. So I type PBI Viz new test visual. Let's call it that. I might call that violin plot or...
What language are you using now?
I beg your pardon?
The language you are using.
This is just PowerShell. So this is the Windows command line. So PBI Viz is a special command that gets installed when you install that SDK we talked about. So if that PBI Viz version doesn't work, so if I ran it and it said it was a bad command, then the SDK wasn't installed. So what I'll do now is I'll run that command. And what it's going to do is it's going to run through its process to create a new visual. So it's got a script that sets up a boilerplate project. So this will take roughly about 30 seconds. Teams does slow it down a little bit sometimes. There we go. So what it's done now is it said it's created a new visual, it's installed the packages, and it's done. So now I can go into my test visual folder, which just got created as part of this process. And in here, I now have a bunch of files. And this process just created that for us. But this is not very exciting. So I'm going to run Visual Studio Code from my current directory, and that will pop up Visual Studio Code. And hopefully that's come up. And this is a bit more visual for us. So that file list we saw has a bunch of files. And this is all set up by the visual. So let's just very quickly have a look at a couple of these. So pbiviz.json, I'm just going to format that so it's a bit easier to read. And why can't I zoom in? There we go. This is the visual manifest. So when you click on a visual and choose the about information, this is where you set all that up. So you give it a name, and this ID here is its unique ID across the world. So when it gets added to AppSource, this ID is the ID that identifies it, so that when your report has this visual in, AppSource will update it if new updates come in. So this is what's used to link your visual to AppSource or make it unique. So we can specify the version, its description, the support URL, and various other aspects. So when we look at our visual as an identity, this is where you set that up. So when we go to AppSource, we see a bunch of stuff in the listing. This is all from that as well. The other thing we talked about was capabilities. So this information we talked about, I'll just collapse this down. This is where you describe your visual's permissions, almost the things you want the visual to do. So these are all standard things that are supported. So this comes with a bunch of defaults, and it has what are three main sections, and there are others you can add, but that's getting advanced. Data roles is what we expose to the main window. So the data roles, the fields, the buckets we expose. This is where we describe those. So we've got one here called, its display name is category data. It's just called category internally. This is its internal name. So this, think of this as its translation, but this is how we refer to it internally. And it has a kind. So a kind is grouping. That's a column. So that basically means create an aggregation for this. If it goes in, this will aggregate measures. And then we have one underneath internally called measure, called measure data in its display name. And it has a kind of measure. So this is basically saying it's a measure, it should be aggregated. You do have the ability to add an extra one called grouping or measure that says it could be either. But that's something you have to think very carefully about. The other thing you have, we'll skip over this one, is the data view mapping. And what this does is it says to Power BI, when these are added to the visuals, when fields and measures are added, how should Power BI return this to me? So in that example earlier, we saw the table come back. I actually have a little bit of control about how that data looks when I get it in my visual. So this may make sense. It's a bit of a concept to cover. But these are the two things we'll just have a look at in a moment when we fire the visual up. The other thing we've got to think about is the two main areas are the source folder and the style folder. So the style folder is easy because it gives us the CSS, the styling for our visual. So in here, we can prescribe how our visual styling should look. And we can see here that this says for a paragraph element, which is a P, give it a font size of 20 pixels and make sure it's bold. And then for an M element, it should have emphasis, that stands for. It should have a yellow background, and it should have 5 pixels of padding around the outside. So this is just simple CSS. And then in the visual.ts, which is our entry point, so when our code runs, this is the code that executes. This is where things start. There's a whole bunch of boilerplate code in here, and this is to get the visual running. But the key part is this here, the class. So a class is essentially a structure. And this is called visual. And this is a feature of TypeScript. So it implements something called iVisual, which is an interface or a shape of something. So with JavaScript, we can't easily determine if an object is correct in terms of its structure. So these implements instructions actually give us a shape. So if we look at iVisual, I can press the F12 key here. It's essentially looking at that code to make sure it fits this shape. So it should have an update method. It should have a destroy. It doesn't need a destroy method. That's when the visual is deleted. You can write some code to clean things up if you need to, which is optional. And an enumerate object instances method, which is a way of dealing with properties, which is a bit too much for today. There is a constructor, and the constructor method runs when the visual is created, and it only runs once. So this is where you do all your setup. So very quickly, what we're doing here is we're doing a debug statement to our web browser's console. People may not know that exists, but this just puts some text there to say that this runs. What it then does is there's an object called options, which is exposed when the constructor runs. And again, we can press F12 on that. And it exposes two things. It exposes the element that the visual is hosted in. So an element is an object on a web page. So it could be a div or a span or an iframe or a paragraph or something like that. But this just tells the visual, here is the information you need to know about that particular element, so you can start to build upon it. And then host is the host services that we talked about. So those tools that let us create tooltips, launch URLs, the API that Power BI gives us, that's the object. So those two things are encapsulated into options. So what we do first of all is we've got something here called this.target, and target is declared here. Target is what's called a property. And this is, it belongs to the visual class. So what happens is that this is something that the visual tracks. Think of it as state, and it's an HTML element. So what that means is that we actually, what we're doing here is we're saying this thing we want to keep, we're going to take the element for the visual and store it so that each time the visual runs later, we can refer to it. So it means that because this only runs once, we don't get it back once the visual is added to the canvas or we change to a report page. But when the visual is created, we also set something called update count to 0. So at this point, the visual hasn't updated, so this gets reset to 0. So we'll see this in a moment, don't worry. And then we just have a quick check here to say if there is actually a web page present, then this effectively adds a paragraph, puts some text in the paragraph that says update count. It adds an emphasis element. So we saw that it was styling for both of those things, paragraph and emphasis. And then it puts the update count into that element. So that 0 value gets put into the element as a text value. We then add those elements to the actual web page. And then that's everything that happens when the visual loads. So I will demonstrate that by doing a couple things. Firstly, I'm going to go to powerbi.com and make sure that I have what I need. So in the service, the first thing we need to do as developers is we need to go to settings. And not our admin portal, but our actual settings. So we have our user preferences and our tenant preferences. So we're going into our user preferences because this is something that, you know, if you've got 300 people in your company, one of you may be a developer. So we don't want to turn this on for everybody. We just want to turn it on for us. Yeah. So we go into settings. And you've probably maybe looked at privacy and language, and there's also this developer option here. So we can click on developer, and we have one setting, which is enable developer mode. So most people will have this turned off. So I live in this mode, so it's always turned on. You can use this whether you've got Power BI Free, Pro, or Premium. So you don't need to have Pro for this. You can use your personal workspace. And this gets disabled. If you sign out, this gets disabled. So it's just something to bear in mind if you use different machines. So if you develop on one machine, then another one, you'll need to turn it on every machine that you're on. So that's just something that catches people out sometimes. But let's now go back to, let's just get our, I've got a simple report here called a simple data set, which is the sample financial data that comes with Power BI when you click on a new report. I've just modeled it into a star schema. So it's no different. It just has some slightly different tables. Now, what we can see, and it may be hard to show, is in the palette, we have a special visual here called developer visual, which most people don't see. And that's enabled because we just made that checkbox. So because we put that checkbox on, we've now got this visual. So I can click on this and I get this blank visual. Now, we get this error that says can't contact the visual server. Make sure that the server is running and configured correctly. So essentially what's happening is this. So I've added my visual to the canvas, but because I don't have a connection and those connections don't have the certificates, it won't work. In my case, I have going through the process is all in the documentation, but I have a certificate. I just haven't started my environment. So in our scripts in Visual Studio Code, we have something called start. And what this will do is we can click the run button here. And this will run a special script that the Microsoft team have provided that will start a local server on my machine. And what this will do is every time I save my changes, it's going to transpile that code and package it up and push it up to Power BI. So right now I've got this compiled successfully, which means it's running. So if I now go back to my Power BI page, now one thing that we noticed with this visual is we have this extra box above it. And these are tools to help us debug. So this doesn't come with every visual. Now I can reload my visual code now because that connection's reestablished. And in a second, I now get my update count and my count of zero. I have no data in my fields. So what that means is that that constructor method we just saw ran and nothing else happened. So if I, hopefully I may have, yep, I did disconnect it, just one second. I'm just gonna put back my, so for those of you that have done web development, you have what's called a console in your browser. And this is where stuff you may not see happens, but when you debug a web page, you can use these tools to learn about the web page that's happening. So if I just reload this, we said that there was a console.log that ran. And that's running here. It says the constructor has run. And then this is the object that got passed through. So the element that we saw, that object that we get through, that's the element that the visual runs in. So this is where we start building our visual. And then we have the host, which is where all those services are exposed. So we have the localization manager. We have fetch more data, which is a way of, you know, it's a way of breaking the row limit. We have the ability to launch a web address. We have the ability to create a tooltip. Yeah, so these are all things that we can see. Now, if we inspect that element using a tool in my console, it's all put inside this div, which is the element that it exposed. And we can see that we have a paragraph. And in that paragraph, we have the text update count and zero. So Power BI, the code that we've written, is pushing this in as part of the initialization. So that's all done. Now, what I can do is I can resize this, and nothing fancy is happening because there's no data in our visual. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm just going to add a measure for now. So I'll just add sales. And what happens now is some extra stuff happened. And that's because as soon as there's data, Power BI is then executing this method, which is update. So anytime something happens to your visual after it's been instantiated, it runs this method. So this is boilerplate code, but one thing it will do is it will process any properties. This is more than we can cover today. But when you build properties, this is how they are evaluated. And then we saw it dumped out visual update and options. And then there's a check here to say, if the text node that was created up here exists, increase the update count. So that was set to zero when we created the visual by one. So what we can see in here is, sure enough, we got the visual update text, and the extra thing it put out was its own options object. So it tells us some things about the visual state. So a good one is viewport. So down here it says that the viewport is 518 pixels wide by 243 pixels high. So we can use that to understand the size of the container, for instance. Now we can see the update count. I'm going to collapse this because for the minute we don't need to worry and we need space. The update count is 2 because 2 of those update methods ran. Now if I resize my visual now, because I have data, it needs to check state every time because something's changed. It needs to work it out. And this is where your logic kicks in. So I can drag this around and we can see that every time the window catches up, it has an opportunity to run some code. And this is how we do things like responsiveness. So when we drag our visual around, you see we have a little window of time that's in the order of milliseconds where we can do a check against that visual size. And we can say, right, our visual needs to now be this high by this wide. So it gives us a way in. So the other thing we need to think about is the data that's in our visual. And we looked at those data roles. So if we go back to capabilities, we had 2. We had category and measure. We've added one to measure. And this, I'll just drag this down. This data view mapping says for each category, bind it to a measure. This is essentially what it's saying. And the documentation goes into this in a bit more detail. So because we have measure, we have something called categorical, which is the type of mapping that we use. There's 4 types. There's categorical, table, matrix, and single. And they all have different quirks. So categorical is probably the most common one. But we have categories and values. So we have categorical. So if I go into Power BI again, I have the ability to do what's called inspect the data view. So if I click on this button and I now get a different view, I can actually open this object up. And I have something called categorical in here. So this correlates with what we just created. And if I expand that, I can see that I have values. So if we jump back to our view, we have a values object here that says bind to measure. And measure is the internal name that we gave to our measure data. But I can see there's no categories object in there. I just have values. So if I now choose product, and put that into the category data, this will refresh because an update has happened. But if I expand the categorical object now, I have 2 objects. I have categories and I have values. And if I open up categories, I have a piece of information here that I'm just going to expand this out a bit. It's a bit hard to zoom this, so hopefully it comes through okay. We have an object called source, and this tells us about the column. So it tells us that it's the product column, or this is what it's named. So I could rename this, and it would come through in here as whatever we call it. And it tells us about its type. So it tells us whether it's a text or a number or a date. And if we have a format from the data model, so if it's a number, we might see the format string there so that we know how to format it. But this is all work we have to do ourselves. The key thing we want to look at, though, is this values. We call this an array, which is a list of values. So in here, if we open this up, this will look more familiar. So we have Paseo, VTT, Velo, Amarillo, Montana, Carretera. So these are the values of the categories that came through. And then in this values object down here, so we have categories and values, Power BI will map those into a corresponding object. So if we expand that down, we now have raw numbers. And the first entry correlates to the first category, and so on and so forth. So this is the way into writing a visual. And it gets so much more wide ranging from here. What we would then do is we would write some code to look at this data view, make sure it's valid, and then map it into how we need our visual to work. And we might call this a view model. And the view model is a way of building something. It's almost like a data model for the visual. It's basically the model our visual needs to do its work. So you might put all your logic in there, but the idea is to centralize it into this view model so that then all the other logic you have just works off that. So it's a put it in one place, almost like a data model, put it in one place and everything springs off it. So this is an incredibly straightforward approach and possibly not more than we can cover today. But to give you an idea, you know, and I don't wish to put people off. it's more about managing expectations. So I'm just going to stop this running. And this is a slight bit of a plug, but I have worked with Radicat, who you may know. I think you've had Reza on your interviews already.
Yeah.
So I've worked with Radicat to produce a course on visuals, which does have a cost. But as part of that course, we produce a fully featured visual. So I'm just going to illustrate that very quickly. But you can see there's a lot more files in here already. And if we look in our capabilities file that we just saw, I've customized this to have a category, a series, and a measure. And I can restrict the number types. And I've got an extra field for tooltips. And I've got what we call objects. So these are properties. I'm just going to collapse that down. I have my data view mapping is a little more complicated, but ultimately this builds it out. In my visual.ts that we just saw, I like to document my code, but we do all the setup in here. So this is doing things like creating interactivity events, creating tooltips. And then in the update down below that we just saw what happens when the visual changes, we get the data view, we get the settings, and we start to work through a set of steps that we need to run each time to make sure that the data is consistent and the visual validates its logic. And binds everything necessary. So think of this as a workflow that then triggers other things. So for instance, I have a chart manager, which then uses a tool called d3.js, which a lot of people use to write charts in JavaScript because it's so convenient to create all the elements that we need. So when we talked about the visual grammar, I'm gonna reload this visual now because it should have loaded. There we go. At the minute, that's missing an extra thing. So we can see on the right here, these have changed now to accommodate a new one called series. And I'm just going to add the year in. And this course, we build a dumbbell chart. So a dumbbell chart shows the span of values from one to another. In this case, it's the sales from 2013 to 2014. But what we do throughout the course is we build the visual up incrementally, starting with the things we just talked about where we did the basic visual and working out how to create everything we need to scale data and place it on the canvas. So when we talked about the visual grammar, with a dumbbell chart, we need a circle element for each data point, and we need to connect these with a line, and we need to space these out based on category, and we need the visual to respond as we drag. So you can see that it scales responsively, and there's a little bit of animation there as well, and that takes a little bit of thought. And we've wired in some properties. So for instance, I can look at the category axis, and what I've done is I've put it on the left because it makes more sense to do that. But if I wanted to, I've written some code, and this is part of the course, where we can click on bottom and it will turn it around so that it's oriented this way. But these are all things that you have to wire up. And honestly, the course itself is about 6.5 hours worth of videos. It may take a bit longer to do in practice. But this will get you a visual that doesn't look too bad. And it has tooltips. And it does have the ability to do cross-highlighting. We don't have any. Let me just add a bar chart here. So if I add a bar chart by, let's put sales on again, and we'll put country on. Slightly different to product. So we can see now that this visual is cross-filtering other bit, you know, just like we would expect. But what we have to do as developers is we have to decide how our visual should look. So a good example would be if I click on United States of America, actually, I'm just going to turn this back on its side because it might be a slightly better illustration. So if I click United States of America, you can see I've told the visual to move the dots for the highlight to show how it relates based on that. But I'm not 100% happy with that as an interaction, but this is the kind of thing as a developer you then have to start thinking about. When people do things in other visuals, what does my visual need to do? And this is where we talked about those hours that go on the end. It's all about making it responsive and polished, and you start to appreciate just how much effort goes into one of these visuals. So you may wow. at times get frustrated with them, but they are incredibly well engineered.
Wow.
I think that's probably about as far as we can take it today, because we'd be here for like half a day. but hopefully it's given you a little bit of a taste of how to get in there. And as I say, this visual has a lot of, you know, all this stuff here is using the D3 framework to handle the web page, to create those elements, to move them around, to work out where they are based on the data, to deal with the animations, what should happen when this happens, all that happens. And then you can do things like, you know, we can manage a state where if we start taking fields out, we can display a landing instead. And what the developer visual doesn't do, so you can actually build multi-language support into a visual. So, but when you're developing your visual through the service, you don't see those translations, but when you build your visual, you see them. So what I've got here are strings that are codes, short codes. So if we look at landing heading in my visual code, I can actually start to build internationalization in. So I can see here that in my US, nice. My landing heading says welcome. So when the visual gets compiled into a PBI viz that you might load from AppSource, it would say, instead of landing heading, it would say welcome. And if I was in the France. French region, bonjour. It would say bonjour. You know, so I can, we actually have the capability of building internationalization into our visual as well. So it also, they've thought about a lot of stuff, but honestly, it's as complex or as simple as you want it to be. I tend to be more on the pedantic side because I was floored when I first saw Power BI's visuals back in 2014. And I really wanted to make sure that anything I produced could maybe try and keep up. But you do learn over time that someone finds something and you can fix it and make it a little bit better. But honestly, it takes a lot of refinement. But you realistically, you can get something working very quickly. So the documentation we talked about, The documentation we talked about has a build a bar chart that works through the setting up of the environment, how to create the project. So some of the things that we perhaps spun over today, just because they do take about 10, 15 minutes. They get easier with practice, just like everything. But looking around how that works. So all the stuff we kind of talked about here with capabilities, data roles, data view mappings, how that correlates to the example that they produce. So they've got examples for tools like if you use React as a web developer, how I can start using React as a framework. And I use React quite a lot in my visuals. How you can build our visuals, and it unpacks everything a lot more. So things like how to get it certified, how to package it up, how to create a dialog box, which is a new functionality that's just added in the last couple of months, how to build visual interactions, how to add tooltips, how to use the analytics pane. There's all kinds of goodies in there. So you can do as little or as much as you like. You know, if you're just doing it for you, you might cut a few corners. But if you want to build something for the marketplace, you want to do a lot of testing and a lot of polishing. This tells you all about that. So the documentation is quite rich. And what I would say is just to build on what we were talking about, Microsoft have a developer in a day course, much like Dashboard in a Day, where they cover all kinds of things. So they cover visuals, Power BI embedded, various other things, where you can learn a bit more about it in a more structured way. Because one thing I am not is structured. And recently Microsoft also did what's called Power BI Dev Camp.
Yeah, I saw that.
Yeah, so Ted from Microsoft, who was previously from, I should remember his company, but he was a consultant and MVP before joining Microsoft. He does a very good 1 hour guide, similar to what we've done, but a little bit more detail on how to set up a visual project and start making tweaks. And it's a good video to watch. I really enjoy it. I like to rewatch things in case I've missed things or done things along the way that maybe have become bad habits. So it was really good to catch up with where things are. And this is quite a good little condensed package of work. If you want to learn for free, this is quite good.
Wow.
So yeah, I think in terms of demoing, building a visual, I would probably leave it here for today, if that's okay.
Thanks so much, Daniel. It's been wonderful. I'm sure people, my viewers are now rethinking about when they see visuals, how much work has gone in, just like how much you not appreciate a dashboard and the work that has gone into the start modeling and the transformation. This is a whole new world on its own. Wow.
I would definitely say one of the challenges, as we've talked about, is the learning the web development. If you as a BI professional have access to web developer, that's going to help you a lot. If you're a web developer, you will need someone to help you with Power BI. That's where the things get difficult, because it's hard to jump straight into developing visuals if you don't know how Power BI works. So there's a little bit of a chicken and egg situation, but it's rewarding if you put the time in, but it does require a lot of time, and that's what puts a lot of people off.
I can see that you, like you said, you're very patient, and that's one attribute that all developers would have to get.
You do learn to be patient, I think. I think the challenge is sometimes when you want something like this, you don't have the luxury of learning on demand, because there's a big buffer between getting something useful to just learning. And when you're learning on the job, it's tricky. But I do appreciate that. So, you know, I do try and pop up on the Power BI community and answer questions where I can. And I do blog every now and again, but most of my focus at the minute is building visuals like Deneb, or helping with Charticulator to empower people without getting down into this level of detail. I think that's ultimately what we're probably looking at. So I'm quite excited about it.
Yeah, we'll hopefully wait on your Deneb interview on the 12th of August with Reed. So
I'm really looking forward to it.
Daniel Mashpatrick with Reed on 12th August. So make a date. Thank you so much, Daniel.
It's been
amazing journey, right from visualization, your background, into the how to build custom visuals. At least you've opened our eyes to, or our minds to, what is possible, and those who want to have a career in that can actually start learning, start early, because you need much time. He's also pointed us to the documentations as well as the videos where you can watch. You can connect with Daniel on LinkedIn, I'm sure on Twitter too, so you get more feedback on the things he's doing. Thank you very much, Daniel. And
thank you once again for having me, Ebenezer.
All my viewers. Hopefully we'll catch Daniel on another day after his Deneb lunch and have one-on-one with him on Deneb. Thank you, and have a good night or good day wherever you may be in the world. Bye. Subscribe to my channel. Bye.